So we are just now in Kyiv, and the conference devoted to 25th anniversary of State Expert Center. And today with me is Francis Crowley. This is the really legend personality, I'd like to say, for my spectators. And thank you so much that you just agreed to talk with us,
Francis.
That's very great privilege and great honor for me. You know, I first want to say for our visitors and for those who will see this video that Francis is absolutely well-known personality in the world of clinical trials. He is especially well-known worldwide in ethical questions, and I know, and you may find out it in many manuscripts, the data about his involvement into clinical trials for many years. I know that you are the member of advisory boards in many ethic committees and so on. I read about that you work in World Health Organization, cooperate with them, you work together with UNESCO, and you know, that's really a huge experience, and I read many manuscripts which you really issued and will prepare. That's why I want to ask you some questions, if you don't mind. Okay?
Please.
Okay.
Hopefully there are nice questions.
I hope so. So, Francis, I know that it is not your first visit to Ukraine, that you have been before over here.
Yes.
And I read, even read your manuscripts in 2012, about prospects and progress of clinical trials in Ukraine. What do you think about the role of clinical trials in Ukraine and prospects of this country? What do you think about it?
Well, I think the, how can I say, I feel that sometimes I watch Ukraine like I watch Belgium or another country to grow up.
Yes.
Or the US even, you see them grow up with clinical trials.
Yes.
You see them, you see how people to think about it, how they mature and how they react. And also how they embrace clinical trials.
Yeah.
And I think Ukraine has been, so when I came to Ukraine, it was mostly through the initiative of the academy.
Yeah.
And they had these bioethics meetings. And at that time, I was doing some advisory work with the WHO, and we had written guidelines for ethics committees. So,
yeah.
Of course, the State Expert Center was young, and you're looking for your way, but many countries, and myself too, we look for our ways.
Yeah.
And I see Ukraine, it grows, and it plays a very important role. I think Ukraine has this very important role on the edge, on the line, let's say, between the CIS countries and European countries. It's a place for interpretation, for transfer of knowledge and so forth. And it has played this role very well since I first came here, and now we see also at the conference it plays this role.
Yeah.
The memorandum of understanding now between Ukraine and Kazakhstan. This trust, this friendship that's here, and even love, you could say. So this is very good. And what I see now is, we can see in the Ukrainian legislation, we can see with the discussion on ethics committees, of course with your own center for oncology studies, we see how this growing up, this development, and this maturity, and this sense of responsibility too. And we feel that there's an appreciation in society too, because it's a contribution.
Yes.
So this, if you see the State Expert Center, how it grows and grows, and
you see it, you had seen it.
Yes.
That's very good. That's nice. So do you believe that we have opportunities for future progress in the That's correct.
Well, I think your opportunities are our opportunities. So that is
that's
true.
That's very good.
This is
okay.
You know,
yeah.
I think sometimes in Western Europe, in the United States, we don't fully appreciate the legacy that you have, the history that you have, So for me to come to Ukraine was to come to an education. And it's because you have this very high level of education, this very good medical, scientific understanding, as well as cultural too. So this is so important, and this is so important in clinical research.
Yes, true.
Because you have very responsible people and capable people.
Thank you. Thank you for this opinion. And you know, the next question, I know that you really are absolutely famous teacher, because you have GCP. We just heard your lectures today. Thank you so much. Was extra very good accepted with the auditor and very interesting. Thank you. I know that you work like the lecture in all the continents, in Africa, in Asia, and so on. And you're just talking about the GCP principles. So that's why clinical trust and ethical principles. How you may just tell it for our people who listen to us. So why it is necessary to follow the ethical principles in clinical trials? No. You are the expert in this way. Why it is important? What do you think?
Well, my background is philosophy, as you know.
Yeah.
But so am I, let's say, known for ethics.
Yeah.
But for me, it's the science that is important.
Exactly.
It's really the science that is important. And the ethics should be to give a kind of assistance or as a kind of, you know, some kind of discussion about that science.
Yes.
And how that, is the science good? And what the impact will be on the patient, what the impact will be on society. So maybe that's where ethics has some help or something. But it's really about the science. Is the science good? And this is why I like good clinical practice, because good clinical practice really just means good research practice.
Yeah.
And if you have good clinical practice, if you do good research, then you will have good ethics. You will have good ethics.
So everything must be honestly and really, really not punish the rights of the patients and so on, not because of it is science. The first is the patient. Is that correct, this idea?
I feel that the first responsibility for an ethics committee is to say this is good science.
Yeah.
And that this science has the prospect to help patients. And then we have to say, well, in order to really know about the safety, the efficacy of the medicine, as you know, as you do every day with so many clinical trials, we have to study this in people. We have to. Of course, you and I would both agree, I think, that if we did not need to study medicines in people, if we could have all the information about the safety and the efficacy from just the laboratory, then we both say we don't study them.
Yes.
We would never do that.
Yeah.
We don't want to take those risks.
Mm-hmm.
We only do it because it's absolutely necessary, because there is no other way. And because if we do not do it, it's not acceptable.
Exactly. Yes.
Because it's not acceptable that we would say, okay, we have all the medicines we have now, and we will not look for new medicines, and we will not try to improve patient health. So we have to do it. So the first question in ethics is it good science, and will that science really contribute to public health?
Yes.
Is it a possibility to contribute? And if we say yes to that, then we can say, okay, now what do we have to take into consideration for these patients that we subject to the clinical research?
Yes.
How can we give them the best environment? Right?
Absolutely.
Yes.
Absolutely. You know, I promise you some unexpected question. You know, so I'm oncologist, so we faced with lung cancer, which is pathology number one and
yes.
reason. So the smoking is the reason why the patients so received this cancer and so on. I paid attention that your last manuscript, which was published in 2017, only a few months ago. So that was very interesting. So I'm for our spectators that so many companies just now produce the electronic cigarettes or such some devices which may change. And I paid attention. It is also for ethical principles that your last manuscript was devoted for that. So is it necessary? So could you just tell us about it? The electronic cigarettes or something which teach the cigarettes and ethnicity and so on. What is this article about? Because it's extremely unusual.
Yes.
I meet it for the first time, yeah. And I was impressed with the idea. What is it about this manuscript?
Oh, it's a lot about this manuscript. So so the manuscript is about the ethical, the scientific and the ethical responsibility to publish science from the tobacco industry.
From
tobacco industry.
Tobacco industry. Okay.
Now, this is, so I think when I publish this, when I write this, actually together with Professor Ricardo Pelosi,
yeah.
I think I ruin my career. I destroy myself. But what happened was we had a journal that came to Professor Pelosi. Professor Pelosi is a specialist in addiction, and he runs a center in Sicily to help people who are smoking to stop smoking.
Yes.
So in addiction there was, now there's in the publication world, quite a few important journals have said they will not publish research from the tobacco industry. They have also said some of them will not publish from the pharmaceutical industry.
Negative results, yes.
Any results.
Any results.
Anything with any connection, we will not publish.
Yeah.
So there was an article in Addiction, an editorial, that said, largely, journals should not publish from this. And Professor Pelosi was contacted by, at the time, the manuscript of that was published, to say, do you want to write a response? So he contacted me, and he said, what do you think? Should we write a response? And I said, well, I don't think this is correct. Because I believe that either you say to the industry, we don't trust you, which is completely understandable.
Yeah.
So you cannot do science. That's okay. That's okay to say. But if they do science, it has to be of a high quality.
Yes.
And we have to check it.
Exactly.
And if you do not publish it,
not different from medical.
No different from any science. From
medication.
Or from medicine. Yes,
the same mode.
But the same thing. And I believe the same thing for pharmaceutical industry.
Yes. Yes. Sure.
If you do the science, you must publish it.
Yes.
And it must be peer reviewed. And people must be able to check the results.
To know results.
Otherwise, it's not science, from my perspective.
Yeah.
So if they are going to do the science, if we say they have to do it. Now, the regulations, even from the WHO, even from the US FDA, which has responsibility for tobacco now, and in Europe, all say that if you want to bring a new product to market, you have to demonstrate something about the health standards for this, which is absolutely important.
Yeah.
So we tell these companies that they have to do research. And we know from the Declaration of Helsinki and all these other things that if you're going to do research, you must publish it.
Yes.
So it's the responsibility, I believe, for the publishers to ensure that. Now there's the other question, of course, about e-cigarettes. And I'm not a specialist here, but as you know much better, of course. Of course, people who smoke regular cigarettes, it's death.
It's
one way or the other, sooner or later. Okay, unless maybe not, but normally it's
finally.
One way, sooner, yes. It's a terrible, terrible thing. And many, many people are addicted. So we see a lot of people stopping and because of a lot of good things. But we know there's a certain group of people that do not stop. And this is where Professor Pelosi is interested.
That's important. Yeah.
And we also know that the e-cigarette, so if you have in combustible cigarette, more than 150 maybe, toxic chemicals. 150 toxic chemicals, huh? Every time you inhale.
Yes,
huh?
Yeah, sure.
And in the e-cigarette, you have maybe 10 or 15 of much lower level, then is it, we have to have at least a discussion in society is, do you want somebody to buy a pack of of these, or do you want to have this? So this was, so I feel, well, I'm not important and it's the end of my career, so nobody will care.
No, I think it's...
But
it's,
I think, I really believe this,
yeah,
and then
that's
what happened then was that Addiction, the journal that asked it from us, refused it.
Yeah.
They refused it, and they gave no good reason.
Yeah.
And we discussed it, and they would give,
yeah,
they would not give us what we considered a good reason.
Yeah.
They did not. We did not see the reasoning.
Yeah.
So we sent it to another journal. It also got refused there.
Yeah.
So the more it got refused,
yeah, sure,
the more I thought.
Okay. Well, thank you so much. Thank you. Very, really unexpected, but necessary viewpoint. So another question. So it is clinical trials, ethic and children, and so we heard about your reports and presentation from ethic principles in child, and I also paid attention for your next manuscript, you know, young children and sports and doping.
Yes.
So that's I just advertised you like the specialists who work with UNESCO, who work with the World Health Association organization, and I found this your manuscript,
yes,
children, sports and doping.
Yes.
So is it really a problem? And so what do you think about that? Because you just the author of this manuscript, not the first one, the author of this manuscript.
No. So this is a manuscript that comes from the European Academy of Pediatrics,
yes,
from the Ethics Working Group. And I'm very thankful to Professor David Neubauer from Slovenia, who's the chairman of the Ethics Working Group, too.
Yeah.
They had some discussion about, because in the Pediatric Working Group, it's not only about clinical trials,
yeah,
but also just generally about ethics in children. So. We discussed, we wanted children to be more active.
Yes.
One of the papers we had was on, we were working on, I think it's maybe published now, is on obesity in children.
Yeah.
So, and also the use of computer games and television and screens and the children they go
so
to school.
So many new factors,
yeah,
new unusual factors.
Yes. They go to school, they come home, they watch the computer screen, they're eating chips. And of course we have this large problem now of childhood obesity too.
Exactly. Yes.
So we wanted to think, well, so we wanted to have children, we also wanted children to be safe, to be secure in sports and,
yes,
and things like this.
Yes.
So we wanted to just encourage a good environment for children.
Exactly. Yes.
Not necessarily competitive.
Exactly.
I was never going to be the best tennis player in the world. Maybe you
but
could be, you could have been a professional.
Yeah. Yeah.
But we're also very concerned because of any kind of enhancement that in children that is used not so much in the interest of the child's health, but to have another benefit, then
yeah,
we worry about that.
Yeah. So you know that's very important that we are just talking with Professor Crowley not about clinical trials, but about the general ethnicity of modern life, and because you are really a philosopher in this, I know about that. And you know, maybe the next very interesting question. So, how many countries and how many countries you had visited before? Because I know that you are switching on from one continent to another. What do you think? How many times you spent abroad in your flights, in your airports, and do you remember or no?
I really don't know how many countries. No,
I
don't know. I
just remember one of our American president, he said, I visited more than 1,500 countries within my presidency. So I have something more to attend, but not so much to attend after my presidency. I believe that it is the same for you also, you know. You know, we discussed with you the clinical trials yesterday, and I've shown you the clinical trial site management system,
yes,
and support of clinical trials, which we just implemented,
yes,
and developed and so on. And so I ask you about your voyages and traveling, because one of the ideas which we try to realize how to make not so overloaded the all employers in clinical trials, even the monitors who live in many, many days, even months per year in hotels, flying from any one place. So my question to you, we have discussed it and shown your presentation. What do you think about, is it necessary to do this kind of work? I'm talking about medical system of site support and
yes,
so on. So Your opinion is extremely very important for me. I'd like to hear what do you think about that.
Well, firstly, I want to thank you because, of course, I would love to come to see your city and your center and to meet all of your the nice people. I think that would I would like that very much. But
thank you.
You saved me 2 airplanes. You know, so this is a big saving for me.
Yeah,
it's
thank
very
you.
Nice for me. Yeah, like this. And I think this is, as we discussed, you know. Saves, it will save for site monitoring, it will save for regulatory inspections, it will save so much logistics and so forth like this. But it is not the most important thing about what your project is. It's not the most important. The most important thing is that you will have data that is clear, that is very manageable, that is precise, very highly precise data, that has much less rate of reduced error, so that's much more easy to analyze, much more easy to track and control, and much easier to share.
Yeah.
Much easier to share. So this is a huge, huge value. Because we need to reduce the number of clinical trials, and we need to reduce, we need to find new pathways, new ways to analyze and verify medicines without necessarily running all these tests through the human person. So the more data we have now, the more we can connect your data with data people in Germany or France or in the US or Australia, the more we can connect your 70 clinical trials with the 70 clinical trials in Boston in oncology and 30 in Germany and the 10 in Belgium or something. When we can put this together, we will know much more about our medicines and we will have much better information, so we will be able to prepare our next clinical trial much better, better endpoints, inclusion, exclusion criteria. But also we will have better, we will know what indications and so forth. So we will treat our patients better when we do this. So this is, I'm sorry, your clinical trials, this is second now. This is the more important thing.
Thank you. So I'm so impressed with your opinion. And maybe the last question for you, the last question. You know, the problem is many years I've worked 15 in clinical trials, and the question is so, sometimes the patient afraid to participate in trials. They are not so good aware with details how the clinical trials are regulated or managed and so on and so on. They not know so good about the ethical principles in clinical trials. But in some countries and in some guidelines, we just now have the, such information. In difficult situations, the clinical trials may be the best option for the patient, and maybe the only chance to save them, and maybe to in oncology, let's say, to overcome the difficulties like just the diseases like immunotherapy, just doing and so on. What you can just now, I hope that many people will see us in our YouTube channel. However, not so many still visit us, but we hope. So, what you may tell for the people who are still thinking about to participate in clinical trials or no? You are a really experienced person in this world or in this system. So, what may you say for them to help them have correct decision for this way to participate or no? So, what is your opinion?
So I often think about this. Suppose tomorrow I go to my doctor just for a checkup.
Yes.
And then he says to me, Francis, I see you have this condition. It's not so good. I'm sorry, it's bad news.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're sick. Now, but I have these medicines here.
Yes.
I can give you these medicines and probably you will get better and you will feel better. But there's a new medicine. And it might work better, especially maybe your condition is very good. You can try that.
Yeah.
But I can't give it to you because we're not sure about it. We have to test it more to know if it really works right and if it's safe. Now, my colleague has a clinical trial. So maybe it's interesting for you. So then I think to myself, how would I react? I've seen this informed consent and I know a little bit about clinical trials, so what would I react? So I say, so probably because I know all this, I will say, okay, well, tell me about the trial, and then I read the informed consent. I'll read all through the informed consent. The doctor will tell me everything about the trial. And then at the end, I have to decide. And you know what I will do? I know it for sure. I will say to my doctor, I say, what do you think? Mm-hmm. I will say to my doctor, what do you think?
What do you say? Your advice, yeah.
I want your advice. And you know what? That's the correct thing to do. It's important the patient decides himself or herself. But I still want to trust my doctor. And all of the clinical research is about trust. It's about trust. That's why your website, your site TV is so important. Because you give all this information
openly.
You share this, you show, you see what it's like when you go in the door, where you register, you see the rooms, you explain to them what a clinical trial is, you explain to them what the risks are, you explain everything to them, okay? So you build trust. It's not the explanation, it's not the information all by itself.
Yes.
The important thing is we build trust. So I think this is the way we will attract patients into clinical research. If we can share with them the information and the vision you have, not just the information, the vision, the understanding you have, we can share with them, then they can really make their own decision, and they can make a decision. It's not should I go into clinical trial or not, but really it's about should I take this route of treatment or should I accept the route of treatment that's experimental. And it's good they can make that decision. It's a privilege they can make that decision.
Okay, so I understand and understood that it is really necessary to attract and to move forward future technologies, but try to use them now. And the slogan of our company is future technologies today. And so I think that I only want to say thank you so much for this interview. I will really pray for our technical system that it recorded correctly everything, because so we were talking so openly and friendly with you. And thank you once again, and once again for our visitors and spectators. It is Francis Crowley, famous researcher from Belgium. It was great honor and great privilege for us to have this opportunity to talk with you, to hear your opinion. I believe it is very important for the people who are who are looking for the new way and how to improve their health. It is very important for society, because we spoke about the cancer, about smoking, about children, about habits, about everything. So I really, for the first time, I'd like to say, I really had opportunity and privilege to meet with real philosopher. It's great honor for me. Thank you so much. Thank you, Francis. Great honor for me, and thank you once again.
And Professor, I want to thank you too for bringing me into the future. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Yes. Thank you. Bye. Bye.